Good evening. I think everyone has arrived now after dropping off their tax returns at the post office. So we will call the April 17, 2018 meeting of the Carmel Plan Commission to order and ask that you all rise and join with us in the Pledge of Allegiance. Lisa, would you call the roll for us, please?
John Adams.
Present.
Laura Campbell.
Present.
Michael Cassati.
Present.
Brad Grabo.
Present.
Tom Kegley.
Present.
Nick Kestner.
Present.
Joshua Kirsch.
Present.
Alan Potasnik.
Present.
Susan Westermeyer.
Present.
Thank you. We have perfect attendance tonight and therefore a quorum. Approval of minutes from our March meeting.
Move to approve.
Thank you both. It's been moved and seconded to approve the minutes as distributed. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed, same sign. Minutes are approved. Communications, bills, expenditures, and report of legal counsel. Mr. Molitor.
Thank you, Mr. President and members of the commission. I'll just mention briefly that you've probably read in the media about the lawsuit that was brought against the county in regard to their signage regulations. And the Superior Court judge did strike down the county's sign regulations. That does not really apply here within the city of Carmel. However, some of the logic of that decision would probably be difficult for us to defend if we had an issue here in Carmel. And therefore, I would just mention to you that I have recommended to the staff that they refrain from, at least during this current campaign, refrain from enforcing sign regulations within the city of Carmel as well. Beyond that, Mr. President, the executive committee did have a meeting prior to this to discuss some procedural issues and also a minor change to the rules of procedure. We have in Article 7, Section 7, paragraphs B and C of our rules relates to the notices that are required for public hearings on administrative determinations. Under our Unified Development Ordinance, we now have the possibility for minor subdivisions to be approved without a public hearing, although those approvals must occur at a public meeting. And therefore, I recommend that we need to insert two words in those sections of the rules to say when notice is required for a public hearing or meeting, this is how the notice is given. And the members of the executive committee unanimously approved that suggestion. So, Mr. President, if you would like to propose that to the members as a change to your rules of procedure, I would recommend that. Thank you.
Thank you. Chair will entertain a motion to insert the words or meeting following the words public hearing, I believe in two locations in our rules of procedure.
And sections, then, Article 7, Section 7B and 7C.
Thank you. And then if there is such a motion, then we can discuss it in more detail if anyone
so moved.
Feels the need.
Second.
Thank you both. Discussion on the motion. Questions or clarification anyone needs? Seeing none, all in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? Same sign. Rules are amended. Thank you, John. Reports, announcements, concerns of the department.
Thank you. First, I'll go over the outcome of the projects at committee for you all. At the commercial committee, the Home 2 Suites Hotel was discussed and then continued to the May 1st committee meeting. The second item relating to IEP therapy and the development plan amendment and related variances, that was our first combination committee hearing. Those items were all approved. And then the third item at the commercial committee was 101 East Carmel Drive and exterior renovation. That was approved subject to some changes worked out with staff. In the residential committee, the enclave of Carmel perimeter fence was approved. The Estancia gate was approved. The college and 116th townhome community was sent back to the plan commission tonight with a positive recommendation, so we will hear them under old business. And then the 9615 College Avenue office building was approved at the committee meetings. On to the public hearing items. I want to announce the tablings. Item number one, which is docket number 18010004Z, Westbridge PUD rezone. That is tabled to May 15th. And then item number six, docket number 18020019Z, 96th and Spring Mill Meridian Corridor rezone. That item is also tabled to May 15th. And that meeting will be held here at City Hall. So just to repeat that, 96th and Spring Mill rezone. If anyone is here for that tonight, we will not be discussing it. That has been tabled to May 15th and will be held here at City Hall. And I believe that is all I have.
Thank you. That takes us into the public hearings portion of this evening's agenda. I will briefly review our rules of procedure for public hearings, and then we will move on to the first public hearing docket tonight. Each public hearing tonight will consist of up to 15 minutes for the petitioner's presentation, followed by general public comments for a total block of 20 minutes of time. The petitioner will then be given the opportunity, if necessary, to respond for up to 5 minutes. The public hearing will conclude with comments from the staff. We ask that during each public hearing that standard decorum be adhered to, and signs of encouragement that are similar to applause, cheering, boos, those kinds of things will not be tolerated. And if we need to ask anybody or remind anybody twice of that rule, you will be asked to leave the room. That said, our first public hearing tonight is docket 18020014, DP Amend ADLS, the Play School at Legacy, building addition. The applicant seeks site plan and design approval for a 2,500 square foot building addition for two new classrooms. The site is 2.01 acres in size. The location is 14454 Community Drive, where the zoning is PUD. Under ordinance, the Legacy Z501-07. The petition has been filed by Brian Cross of Civil Site Group on behalf of the owner, the Play School at Legacy. Brian.
Can you hear me now? Okay. Good evening, President Grabo. Brian Cross with Civil Site Group. Offices at 160 West Carmel Drive here in Carmel. Here before you this evening on this new petition for a building addition for the Play School at Legacy. In 2014, the Play School Legacy built their first preschool in Carmel, and I'll give you the location exhibit here. Turn it the right way. So 146th Street is the top of the page here. Community Drive goes south from 146th Street. River Road to the right of the page here. Their facility is located on about 2 acres of land, approximately 1,000 feet south of 146th Street. Their first phase of the project was about a 14,800 square foot preschool facility. They are expanding at this point. Two new classrooms are proposed. If you look at the southeast quadrant of the property, this aerial photograph shows the existing facility, and the red outline here is where two new classrooms will be constructed. This was originally designed as an architectural element of this hallway to be expanded further south on this portion of the property. So this was contemplated in some future planning we did in 2014. We weren't expecting to go this quickly 4 years later, but we're really excited to get this ongoing here. You'll look in your packets as well. You'll see the engineered site plan. again, the red area here to the southeast of the property. It's currently used as playground space. This particular area will be fenced off and tied into the building. They have sufficient playground area on property to meet the state requirements, and there won't be any impacts to their playground structure. It's kind of a blow-up view of that particular location as well. Landscaping doesn't really get affected other than we're adding some additional plantings at the corner of the structure. We do have to temporarily take down the fence to get access to construction and for the foundations of this building addition, but then it'll be restored with new additional landscaping in that quadrant. Architecturally, this building addition will match identically to the existing structure. So what you see here is an expansion of the east wall. The shaded portion here is the existing structure, and we're tying in the roof line to match. It is a hip roof. These architectural elements and doorways, the lanai area off to the side here will match the same existing condition on the building as you go north. This other element kind of gives you a three-dimensional rendering of this entire structure. The shaded portion is the existing structure. This is kind of a unique aspect of this particular document because this shows you the structural elements of all the framing as well. But what you see in colorized element in the bottom of the page here is the actual building addition for the two classrooms. And again, materials and colors will match the existing. We have black and white building elevations as well in your packet. Certainly not as uniquely diverse as a three-dimensional element here. So what the play school is asking for is approval from Plan Commission this evening for this building addition. There's no additional parking spaces required on site for this addition. It's just a matter of a 2,500 square foot building addition to the southeast corner of the property. We've been working with staff, we've been working with engineering. We have no further outstanding comments with any of the departments. And I think that if it would be appropriate, we would request final approval tonight through the Plan Commission and forego special studies if staff concurs. Thank you.
Thank you, Brian. We'll continue the public hearing with any comments from members of the general public. Is there anyone who wishes to speak either in favor or in opposition to this petition? Seeing none, we'll proceed to the department report.
Thank you. As we heard, the petitioner proposes a two-classroom addition to the east wing of the existing building. These classrooms will be in line with the existing building, as we saw, which faces Community Drive. The addition will follow the same site plan and architectural design as is there today. There are 59 parking spaces that are required, and there are 41 spaces on their existing lot, and then there are 19 spaces adjacent to the site on-street parking, which is allowed by the PUD to count towards their parking requirements. So they have sufficient parking for this facility and for the add-on. Sidewalks and bicycle parking exist today. They meet the requirements of the PUD, and they will not be altered by this proposal. As was mentioned, the design matches what's there today, and hopefully we will not be able to tell that this was an addition at all because it will be the same colors, the same materials, the same style. Landscaping will be added at the south perimeter of the building and will help screen the new AC units, and then the plants that are affected during the construction will be removed and replaced. The urban forester has signed off on the landscape plan. There are no changes to lighting or signage. This proposal does meet all PUD standards for the building and site design. We do not have any outstanding comments or concerns for this proposal. We do recommend that you vote to suspend your rules tonight to vote to approve this item. Thank you.
Thank you. That closes the public hearing for this docket. Questions, discussion within the commission? Joshua.
First, when did this originally come through?
It was 2014, January Plan Commission, I believe.
It was true of my memory. Second, I move to suspend rules and procedures.
Thank you. Is there a second? Thank you, John. All in favor of suspending our rules to take a final vote on this docket this evening, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Same sign. Rules are suspended. Discussion continues. Brian, I've got a couple of questions.
Sure.
And primarily it's just helping me find them within the plans. I saw the delineation of the existing fence. Can you show me where the new, the replacement section of fence will be located?
I can.
And perhaps while you're at it, if you could identify the building setback line on the south end of the property.
Okay. You can see this exhibit. The red outline is the building addition, obviously. The blue line, this is the southern property line. And then it transverses up through the right-of-way on Community Drive here. So as far as setbacks, the fence currently is approximately 6 feet or so north of the actual property line. And that's their playground fence, their perimeter playground fencing. So the building addition is roughly going to be 3 feet or so from the existing fence. So with a construction project like this, obviously we have to make a safe zone for the children's play area, the outdoor play area. So we'll be doing temporary fencing to keep them away from that. But the final fence line will still meet the existing current fence line with two exceptions. There'll be a return fence at each corner of the building. So we'll keep the same character as a perimeter fence, but as we talked to the owners on this one, we wanted to segment off that little southern end of the building so no kids can get past that playground area.
Okay. And then the building setback line on the south end of the property?
5 feet is the setback off of the south line, and our building is 9.4 feet from the south line.
All right, thank you. And then last question, what steps will be taken to protect the on-street parking so that it remains available for clients of the play school as well as the commercial uses across the street during construction?
During construction? That's a good question. We'll be working with Platinum Properties, who's the manager for Legacy Development. We're going to be looking at staging some different areas for contractor parking as well as material staging. It's a unique location to have a construction project right along a streetscape like that. So we'll be working with Paul Rio on that. We'll also be working with the Play School's contractor on locating their specific subcontractor parking to be in a site other than Community Drive. When this facility was being built in 2014, that was a concern with the fire department as well, so we addressed it at that time. We had much more property, but let me also address it by saying if you look at the Play School's property, their parking lot here, they have sufficient area here to utilize as staging and parking as well. So it's a good question.
Thank you. Other questions for the petitioner? Or a motion?
Move for positive recommendation. Approval.
Thank you. Thank you. All in favor of approving docket number 18020014 DP amend ADLS, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Same sign.
Thank you very
approved.
Much.
Thank you. We have two different docket numbers that I'll read in together for our next item. It's 18020015 DP amend ADLS, IU Health North Campus Cancer Center, and docket 18020016 ZW of ordinance Z-409-03, section 2, Roman numeral 4, letter A, 2, Roman numeral 2. Minimum building height in area 1A is 38 feet, and three occupiable stories are required versus 45.5 45 feet 4 inches and only 2 occupiable stories proposed. The applicant seeks site plan and design approval to add a cancer center building with 2 stories at a height of 45 feet 4 inches, totaling 88,000 square feet, to the existing hospital campus. The site is located at 11700 North Meridian Street, within the existing parking lot located to the south of the hospital. The zoning is PUD within the Clarion North Hospital Campus PUD. Petition is filed by Tim Oakes of Ice Miller on behalf of IU Health. Tim.
President, members of the commission, good evening. Here this evening representing Indiana University Health with respect to the proposed expansion of their North Campus to include an 88,000 square foot cancer center. This is tab 2 of your booklet, and on it you will see an aerial of the existing campus. The approximate location of the cancer center is outlined in white on this aerial. It will be 2 stories, as mentioned. Although it meets the height requirement, as indicated, we are requesting a waiver of a requirement that it contain 3 occupiable floors. The basis for the request is related to the type of use under the regulations and safety guidelines that apply to care facilities like this. We cannot build space that we're not going to use. It all has to be genuinely occupied. We can't build a faux third floor or an empty third floor and then come back and fill it in. That won't work for this, for a hospital type building of this type. What I will say is structurally it is being designed so that, unfortunately, since it is a cancer center, you don't want to have to expand a cancer center if you don't have to. But it is being designed structurally so that it can be expanded upward up to 5 stories, and as the need arises, then it will be expanded upward. This is the site plan. If you turn to tab 3, it's generally located to the south of the existing hospital. It will be connected to the existing hospital by a walkway. The walkway will be at grade level. It will be a split walkway in the sense that one side will be accessible by the public, the other side will be only accessible by staff and medical personnel. This is a little bit better view. This shows the entirety of the campus. On the far north part of the campus is a 514 space parking lot that will be added. That was approved with a DP ADLS approval back in July of last year. Construction start is imminent. We've been delayed a little bit by the weather and then also utility relocation. That will help alleviate any parking issues both during construction and obviously be permanent and remain there after construction as well. The proposed use is permitted under the PUD. And we meet all of the development standards in the existing PUD, save the one waiver that we are requesting. Overall, the required number of parking spaces is 1,294, including the north parking lot. The total number of spaces will be 1,817 parking spaces. There will be a slight loss of spaces that currently exist that the new building will cover, but the new parking lot will compensate for that. And adequate parking will exist for those persons coming to the cancer center with the parking lots that will be reconstructed on the south and west sides of the building. The goal for this building is to build to LEED Silver standards. and the design of the building is intended to be compatible with the existing hospital structure. If you turn to tab 4, this is the landscape plan. The first document, L1-1, shows the landscaping around the building itself, and for the parking lot, we have met with the urban forester and received his comments, and we believe they're favorable. The next page is even a little bit closer, in a smaller scale, a larger scale, in terms of the landscape plan itself. The landscaping, it will be significant around the foundation and perimeter of the building, as well as a significant amount of landscape in the parking lot. The sidewalks and paths have been designed to basically extend the system that already exists at the current hospital. Lighting will be used the same poles and light fixtures as the existing campus, which uses LED lights. If you turn to tab 5, it's probably the most telling of the booklet in terms of what is actually being proposed. Again, the building has been designed to be completely compatible and consistent with the existing hospital, with the use of brick and limestone. This elevation, which is I have up on the screen, is looking from the east to the west, slightly south of the building. This elevation, again, is of the building, looking this time a little bit further north, back to the west once again. This is on the other side of the building as you're looking at the proposed structure. And then finally, the fourth side of the building. This is the side that we're standing to the west of the building, looking directly, or standing south of the building, looking to the north. We've had a chance to meet with staff, and I think those meetings have gone well. We are thankful to staff for all the effort that they've put into this. We're in agreement with the staff report, and we'd be happy to answer any questions that the Plan Commission might have.
Thank you. We'll continue the public hearing with comments from members of the public. Anyone who wishes to be heard in favor or in opposition to this petition? Jill?
My name is Jill Meisenheimer, and I represent CCRZ Carmel Citizens for Responsible Zoning. I just have two questions that I'm confused about that I hope you can address. One is, I can't quite see how the parking lots and entering and moving around to the emergency room will be done in an easy way. So I guess I would like to see on a map how you would come from the entrance to get to the emergency room, both during construction and afterwards. I say this because, unfortunately, our family has had far too many trips to the emergency room, and anybody that's going to the emergency room, when you're in a crisis sort of state, you would like to make it really clear and easy to be able to get there. I'm sure that that's been considered, and you know, for ambulances too, but I would feel better if I just knew how this was going to work, if you could show that path. And the second thing is, according to the documents, I saw that there was going to be a new entrance from Illinois to get to the cancer center, and I would like to see that actually, you know, how that would look, and if how that might affect the traffic, because we, between 116th and you know, going down Spring Mill, we did, the Plan Commission, City Council did eliminate one of the entrances from Spring Mill going into Jackson's Grant, and so this is adding a new entrance, and I just wondered how that all would work. So I'm just curious how this would be laid out. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else who wishes to be heard this evening? Seeing none, then Tim, there you are. I lost you. If you'd care to respond.
Sure.
Any further comments?
I'll use this aerial to respond to a couple of those questions. The new entrance that was referred to would be a right-in, right-out located right here. As you can see, there's a raised grass median that would force that to be a right-in, right-out. We have met with Jeremy Cashman in the engineering department about this entrance and done a detailed traffic analysis of that. So that would be installed. When it's first installed, that would be used as a construction entrance only. When the cancer center is complete, that would remain as a right-in, right-out to be used primarily for patients and visitors coming to the cancer center. In terms of the emergency access during the construction period, until this really gets ramped up over in this area, the construction routes will be maintained. Once things really start moving on the construction side, this will be shut down here, so you won't have access over here. This access point, however, will remain an emergency vehicle access, an emergency vehicle access only. A new sign will be placed there indicating that it's emergency access. So the emergency vehicles will come in. The emergency entrance is on the east side of the hospital, which is the bottom of the aerial that you're seeing. A secondary, you always want to have redundancy when it comes to emergency access routes. So the secondary access route will be coming in off the main entrance, and that will then come around the north side of the building and around. And then finally, a non-primary emergency access will be available over on the far northern access point here. And then the emergency vehicle or someone transporting their, say, sick children in the emergency room could come in this way as well. So those three independent routes will at all times remain in place during construction. So we don't see any impact in terms of emergency access to the hospital. So with that, again, we'd be happy to answer any other questions.
Thank you. Department report.
Thank you. As we have seen, the petitioner proposes a new building to be located on the south side of the existing hospital. It will be placed within the existing parking lot with parking areas and drive aisles adjusted to lead pedestrians and vehicles to the front door of this new building. A new right-in, right-out entrance off of Illinois Street will be added to provide direct access to this new facility. And I have mentioned in the department report in the PUD, three full access points are allowed off of Illinois Street, and one right-in, right-out is allowed. So there's one full access existing now, which is the main entrance in the middle. There's one full access proposed at the north end of the site, which will be constructed when they finish the new parking lot to the north that we approved last year, if you remember. And then this one will be an added right-in, right-out at the south. So what will exist will be two full cuts and one right-in, right-out per the PUD requirements. So I just want to let you all know that they are doing things as the PUD says. And as I was talking about that new parking lot to the north that we approved last year, that lot will have 532 spaces overall. The site, the entire site, will have 1,817 spaces. Only 1,294 spaces are required based on the use. 280 parking spaces will be removed due to this new building's construction, and 34 spaces will be added. So So all that's detailed in your department report as well. The new building will be primarily two stories in height, with a small portion of the building extending to three stories adjacent to US 31. And as the petitioner indicated, the building will be constructed so that a full third story could be constructed later on if need be. Three occupiable stories are required by the PUD, and therefore that's why they are asking for the waiver for the height for only a partial third story. This building will be connected to the existing hospital building, both outside via a sidewalk and indoor via a enclosed covered walkway. The architectural design of the building follows the standards set by the existing hospital building, and it'll be constructed of brick, stone, glass, and have metal panel accents. And we have been working with the petitioner on the design of the building and feel that it has come, it looks very nice the way that it is proposed now. New sidewalks will be provided, guiding pedestrians to the front door as well as to the network of sidewalks throughout the campus. When the new parking lot was approved last year to the north, the petitioner committed to coming into compliance with the bicycle standards, bicycle parking standards of the UDO, if you remember. And the petitioner has proposed to install all of those bicycle parking racks with this project, so they will be making good on their commitment. The proposed parking lot light fixtures will match the existing lights of the campus. There will also be building accent lighting. There will be extensive landscaping. There will be signage that meets the sign ordinance and PUD requirements. And there are only a few outstanding items to take care of. So we would recommend that this go to the Commercial Committee on May 1st with final voting authority at the committee level. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the public hearing for these two dockets. Discussion, questions from members of the Plan Commission? Mrs. Campbell.
Is this building, would it be covered under the current pilot agreement, or does a new agreement need to be drawn up?
It would be covered.
Mr. Potasnik.
Thank you. Tim, I just want to make sure I have an understanding of this, and it's going to be to Jill's point here. So both of these hospitals, the existing hospital and the cancer center, will be joined, so you can have access from either one of those buildings to the other.
Correct.
Tell me this. I want to make sure I have this right. Each hospital will have its own emergency room?
I'm going to ask these folks to scream at me if I answer this incorrectly. In a technical sense, I don't believe the Cancer Center will have an emergency room. We dedicate it solely to the care of cancer patients, so there'll be doctors there and all kinds of facilities, but an emergency room where someone comes to be treated for emergency care, where they've been cut, they've been in a car accident, they've been hurt, that will only be at the hospital.
I see. Well, I guess when I was looking at your explanation, that it seemed to me that the entrance to the emergency room in the cancer center was like in the southwest portion of the building. Did I misunderstand that?
No, there's three entrances, and if I could get the overhead on, probably answer this a little bit better. Thank you. So the emergency access I referred to was intended to be emergency access to get to the hospital, and there's two types of emergency access. There's
when you say the hospital
That's the existing hospital.
Okay.
I'll use the words existing hospital and cancer center.
Okay, very good.
So we won't get confused. So when I say let's maintain emergency access for the existing hospital, that's what I'm referring to. And there's two types. There's emergency vehicle access, which is ambulance bringing somebody in. And then there's my child has slipped and they fell, and I'm taking them to the emergency room.
Right.
This access here will be emergency vehicles only. So it's the quickest and fastest way in, and the quickest and fastest way to the emergency room access point, where sometimes seconds can count. That's the way it is today, and that will remain that way during construction. And that, quite frankly, is probably the most important. Then emergency room access for everyone else, which can include emergency vehicles, but for folks that are just driving their own car to the emergency room, there's two. One will continue to be the main entrance, where you'll come in to the main entrance and then swing to the north side of the building to come around. And then the secondary, our redundant emergency access, would be, instead of coming in through the primary entrance, would be to come in through here. And then this is a direct route back to the emergency room as well.
Okay. Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Mr. Kirsch.
To kind of further belabor that point, has staff kind of given you the A-OK to put up temporary signage that says, yo, emergency room this way, come save our life this direction?
Well, there already is directional signage at the site, so it will be supplemented, and we have had discussions with engineering about that, yes.
Okay, that's great. Another question. In the future, if we're looking at this, and it's kind of hard to see, but kind of, I guess, to the west of the vestibule or breezeway or whatever that connection is between the new cancer center and the existing hospital, correct? Mm-hmm. So there's kind of a bit of a roundabout there.
Yes.
Will that also serve as an emergency, you know, for like my kid fell and hurt himself? Yeah.
They can go in that way, and that will be a roundabout. You can see the design right here for patient drop-off and pick-up as well. Yes.
Okay, one last question. Maybe it's a little bit more visible on the map that I'm looking at right now, but if you wanted to get into the parking lot that would be to the far south and east, correct, is that a bit of a frontage road on the south part of the property that would get you there?
This is a, I guess you could call it a frontage road. It'll just be an access road.
Okay.
That will get you the southern parking lot. Yes.
Okay. That's all I've got. Thank you so much.
Mr. Kessner.
Okay. The emergency exit on the 116th, or entrance, couldn't that be just labeled emergency entrance only?
Yeah,
instead of vehicles, emergency vehicles? Because if I'm coming across going west and I can see the emergency department, I'm going to pull in there.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not going to go figure out how to get through the parking lot and get back down to a place that I can see right now.
The current plans contemplate having a sign right there at that entrance off of 116th Street, and we're more than happy to work with staff on exactly what language that says with that very intent in mind.
So just so I understand, I find it confusing right now, and I've gone down that ambulance entrance myself driving my car, just because I'm not, when you're in, just as you mentioned, and it has nothing to do particularly with this expansion. Although, my question, are you going to have a sign at the new southern entrance on Illinois that says cancer center only? I mean, these complexes start getting so large, mm-hmm. and because then there'll be something else coming, and I've especially seen it happen at community. And then people coming aren't always in the best of health anyway.
Sure.
How are you going to differentiate somebody coming to the cancer center or someone coming to the hospital, I kind of wish IU would take a look at how they enter into that emergency room right now by vehicle, because I don't think people can see it coming in on the west side easily. I know you have signs posted, but I've always thought there could be a better job done on that.
Well, in terms of this entrance, initially it will be a construction entrance only, and it will be labeled with a sign, construction vehicles only. But once complete, we're certainly willing to put up any sign that the city wants with respect to directing, you know, patients that are going to the cancer center to use that entrance, or even a sign that says main hospital entrance with an arrow. That's certainly something we're willing to discuss. Anything that avoids confusion, we're in favor of.
Joshua?
One more question, Ms. Rokes. So you're building basically 2.5 stories, more or less?
Yes.
Okay. But you're building it with the anticipation that you could build several more stories on top of it. Is
yes.
that correct? And why go through that exercise and not just make a complete third story and get the variance?
When you have this particular type of healthcare facility where you can have people in rooms overnight under care, you can't have empty, unoccupied rooms. It's not permitted by the medical regulations, for lack of a better word. So they can't build a third floor and not staff it and not have it operational like the rest of it. And it's, you know, right now, the demand, we'll see, in terms of whether or not they can fill a third floor or not. If they can, then I suspect it will be built because it's designed that way. If it can't, they can't build it and not have it occupied, then the operating expenses are crazy, and it doesn't really make much sense.
I mean, I really hate to even think about it, but I'm going to compare it to the daycare that we just saw come through. I think the need is pretty good. But I guess we'll see you back here in the future, and you'll figure that out. Mm-hmm. I got to say, I got one more question for you.
Sure.
Doesn't IU Health want to make this facility that much better by adding a roundabout at their entrance off of Illinois?
That is something we can discuss. I mean, a traffic engineer has been engaged in those discussions. Extensive discussions has occurred with Jeremy and the engineering department.
Okay.
And so that discussion certainly can continue at the committee
our
level.
Our vote's probably not going to hang on that, but it seems to me to make the facility that much better, safer, et cetera, that it might be a consideration you want to make. Thank you very much.
Mr. Kegley.
I mean, the folks from IU Health, I mean, you know this, but I know this because of my own particular circumstances. But in terms of directional signage, the emergency department's a place that people hopefully don't go that frequently to. In other words, they don't make repeated trips back to it. But the cancer center is one that once you start, you go there a lot. So you don't need a lot of directional signs. Once you found it the first time, you know where to go to find it in the future. So in terms of having additional signage, just saying this is where it is, once you found it, you know where it is.
Any other questions or discussion? Or a motion on how we wish to send this to committee for further work?
On to the commercial committee with final voting authority.
Second. Thank you both. All in favor of forwarding this to the commercial committee on May 1 for further review with final voting authority, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, same sign.
May
1 at commercial committee. Thank you. Next on our agenda is docket 1802-0018Z, 969 North Range Line, C2 rezone. The applicant seeks approval to rezone approximately 4.71 acres to the C2 mixed-use district. The site is currently zoned B3 business within the Range Line Road overlay zone. Location is 969 North Range Line Road. Petition has been filed by the Department of Community Services on behalf of the Carmel Plan Commission. Adrian.
Thank you. My name is Adrian Keeling with the Department of Community Services. I'm here this evening with Henry Mistetsky with the Carmel Redevelopment Commission, and we're here to talk to you this evening about rezoning the property at 969 North Rangeline Road from the B3 Business District in the Rangeline Overlay to the C2 Mixed Use District. As you can see on the map, the property is on North Rangeline Road, just north of Dairy Queen. That's a local landmark on North Rangeline. And it is currently occupied by the Indy Auto Imports used car dealer. I won't get into specifics. I'll let Henry talk about the project as it relates to the Redevelopment Commission, and then I'll close after Henry talks about the project with why this is a little bit different than the previous C2 rezonings that we've had in the past. Thank you.
Thank you so much for having me. Henry Mistetsky, Redevelopment Director. The CRC is currently engaged in continuing to build out our Midtown area, and the success there is already evident with Allied Solutions and MJ Insurance coming in, as well as the Merchants Bank headquarters. And there are still some remaining areas where there are viable local businesses that are still in that area, and the CRC is requesting this rezone to help essentially facilitate transition of some existing businesses to other areas so we can continue bringing large corporate headquarters to the Midtown area. And that's that. And I respectfully request that you approve the zoning petition.
Thank you. Public hearing will continue. Is there anyone who wishes to speak in support or opposition to this petition? Seeing none, we'll proceed to the department report.
We'll defer to Adrian.
Yeah. This proposal, as I mentioned, is a little bit different than the previous C2 rezonings that we've had in the past. More recently, you've seen larger swaths of parcels or entire blocks that we have proposed to position an area for development or redevelopment. This proposal is a little different because it's one specific parcel with a specific purpose in mind. It's also perhaps a little less onerous because there are no detached homes in the immediate area. Carmel Woods Apartments are to the north, and the Carmel Cemetery is across the street, and the remainder of the area is commercial in nature. Because of the specific nature of this proposal, we recommend that you suspend your rules this evening and vote to send this with a favorable recommendation to the Carmel City Council. Thank you.
Thank you. That closes the public hearing on this docket. Discussion, questions from the Plan Commission?
Can I jump in?
Yes.
I have a little bit intimate relationship with this proposal. Just to kind of piggyback what both Adrian and Henry have said, I think this is a great plan to help some other businesses in our area stay in our area, but free up some other space for other people to come to our area, if that makes sense. I move that we suspend our rules and procedures and vote tonight.
I want to emphasize.
We have a motion on the floor.
I'm sorry, I missed.
Second, or will the motion die for lack of a second?
I had a question.
There is a motion to suspend the rules to vote on this petition tonight. Is there a second to that
second.
Motion? Thank you.
Now can I ask a question?
Germane to the motion?
Germane to the proposal.
Okay, the motion is on the table at the moment.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Or on the floor at the moment. So discussion on suspending our rules. Seeing none, all in favor of suspending our rules, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? Okay, rules are suspended.
No,
Mr. Adams.
Question. Thank you, Mr. President. I had a question about exactly what might happen here. Would the existing business potentially move to another location and open up that parcel, or would this just help the existing business stay there?
I think we are assuming that the existing business, which is a tenant in the building owned by the property owner, is going to move out and move somewhere else, and this site will be redeveloped to help facilitate movement of other businesses from a more central core location.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Kessner.
The one question I have is why don't you go down to the trail, include all that property? There's some other areas that are pretty bad in that area while you're at it.
You mean why this specific piece of property but not other pieces of property?
I'm talking more about the area than just one piece of property. That whole quadrant there from the apartments down to the trail needs to look, I think, be looked at as a whole, not just piecemeal.
I would definitely agree with that. I think here we're also subject to the whims of the marketplace, and certainly if we're moving or we are attempting to facilitate the movement of businesses that are used to being around Rangeline Road, and especially obviously for our retail and other property owners or businesses, Rangeline frontage is an important piece, and so we are ultimately at the whims of what's on sale and what's not on sale in the marketplace, and the kind of needs that potential business relocations will have to help address, navigate. And so for now, this is the opportunity that's in front of us, but I totally agree that as much of this area as we can renew, that's certainly our purpose and our goal.
Mr. Casati? No? I just have one question. Under the C2 mixed-use district right now, auto service use is not a permitted use. So would there be a variance to follow, or is there a way to accommodate that use in this rezone?
Since,
or do I need to practice my UDO reading skills?
I'm just double checking that. I looked at that previously. But I have a lot of districts and a lot of uses that float around in my head, so.
There was two people here. We were counting on getting this right. It was you and Brad.
You are correct that auto service use is not specifically listed in a C2 district. It is also currently prohibited by the rangeline overlay, but since that has been in existence, then they are allowed to remain in existence until such point that there would be a vacancy for a year. So it could remain under quote-unquote grandfather status, but that's something that we can look at if, you know, plans arise that involve continuing an auto business or adding to an auto business, then we can take a look at remedying that on a more permanent basis.
Thank you. Mr. Casati.
Move to forward to the City Council with a favorable recommendation.
Second.
Thank you both. All in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. This proceeds to the Council.
Thank you very much.
Thank you both. Next item on our agenda is docket 18030002Z10680 and 10664 North College rezone. The applicant seeks approval to rezone approximately 0.7 acres to the B1 business zoning district. The site is currently zoned R3 residential and is within the home place overlay business subarea. It is located on College Avenue near 107th Street. The petition has been filed by Simon Gao on behalf of the owner, Zhali Zhang.
Mr. Hello. Gao. Good evening, Mr. President and Commissioners. My name is Simon Gao. We are petitioning two parcel properties on 116th Street and College Street, College Avenue. That's right in the center of the home place. And this is about, this is 106th Street. I'm sorry, not 116, 106th Street, and this is a college. The two properties here on the red outline that went to the south, 10664, used to have two doubles rental houses. Now it has been demolished, turned it down. It's an empty lot now. The property right north of that, 10680, has a single family residential home. So there has been, the petition is to rezone it to business use. Both of them currently on R3 to B1 for office rental. So that's kind of summary of the petition.
Great. Thank you. Members of the general public who wish to speak on this petition in support or opposition? All right, we'll move on to the department report.
Thank you. The applicant is proposing to rezone two parcels from R3 residence to the B1 business zone. They are within the home place overlay business sub area. The intent of this rezone is to tee up the site for future development and use the existing house for an office use. So as the petitioner stated, the north building will remain and they'd like to use that for office, and the two homes on the aerial that you see have already been demolished, and that site would come back for development plan approval in the future. The comprehensive plan for the City of Carmel delineates this area as a community vitality node to establish areas for community serving and neighborhood serving commercial development. The land to the north, south, east, and west even of this site are also in this same classification for in the comprehensive plan. So we feel this is meeting the comprehensive plan for a neighborhood serving commercial area to rezone it to a business zone, and it also is, I think, the intent of the home place business sub-area overlay, which that is intended to foster urban neighborhood village-like commercial activity in keeping with the intention of the comprehensive plan. It is to contain office and retail uses that are of an intensity and scale compatible with the surrounding residential areas, both in scale and architecture. No signage is proposed at this time, and any future signage will need sign permit approvals. The existing parking on the northern parcel will be used for parking for that office building. However, to accommodate enough spots for the office use, they will be using part of the southern lot as well. I think he has a revised drawing to show that they can accommodate all seven spots, which would be required per the ordinance for office. And I believe he's also showing, is that the 10-foot path along College? That's another requirement.
That's, yeah.
is to have a 10-foot path along both properties and to dedicate right-of-way. So there's still, there are a couple outstanding items. They've addressed the parking, I believe, now. As a part of this rezone, we would recommend that there be a commitment that the 50-foot half right-of-way is required along College, that that be dedicated at this time. And then the 10-foot multi-use path, which is required within the right-of-way, could either be built on just this parcel, and then when the future parcel comes through for a development plan, they could build it there, or the ordinance does allow them to make a commitment to our thoroughfare fund for just for the cost to construct the path, because there is a sidewalk there today, and the path wouldn't necessarily connect to anything. So they could just commit those funds today for this parcel again, and then the southern parcel, we would address that when they come through for their development plan. And then one other item that would be required for the office use on the north parcel would be 4 bicycle parking spaces. So we'd ask them to show that on their plan, and when a use goes in, they would need to install those bicycle parking spaces. This is in within, again, the home place overlay zone, so any future improvements to this site or to the site to the south will require review by the Plan Commission for an ADLS amendment or a DP-ADLS for the southern parcel. So if they're willing to commit to those items this evening, we would recommend a favorable recommendation of this to the City Council. I believe that would require suspension of the rules, but that would be our recommendation. Thank you.
Thank you. Questions, discussion from Plan Commission? Mr. Potasnik.
Mr. Gow, with regards to those remaining comments or concerns, would you mind addressing those? Are you willing to commit to those things this evening?
We're fine. We're fine in general terms. That we had a conversation with the Alexia and the department. So in terms of giving the right-of-way part of the property on the front, that's definitely something we have a commitment to do that. I think we had a conversation. We have ongoing conversation with the engineer department. I left a message to talk with staff there. We are committed to whatever the policy is to comply with that.
Okay. Well, I just was, my point is, we're being asked to approve something and actually to sign off on something. And I just want to make sure that you, with your commitment, agree to do those items that staff says is still remaining to be done.
Yeah, absolutely. The things, I think the other things Alexia mentioned, that bicycle rack stuff, it's just we didn't put it in there because at this point the house is there but no tenants there. No tenants has been fined yet. So we don't even know the issues related, potential issues about signage, for instance, because there's no tenants there. So it'll be after that and we will do the pavement and parking lot at that point, bicycle space will be carved out.
Okay. Okay.
Mr. Adams.
Well, correct me if I'm wrong, Alexia, but I think we're going to have more than the gentleman's verbal agreement, aren't we? Don't we have to have some kind of a written commitment on this rezone that goes forward, or what's your opinion on that?
Yes, I think it would be a commitment of the approval. So he would make the commitment, and it would be written, a written commitment with the rezone as it gets approved by the City Council.
Be written into the minutes, so to speak, or into the approval document?
Okay. Ideally, into the approval document with the rezone. Mm-hmm.
Counselor, do you have any thoughts on that?
It does seem to me that this should entail a written commitment that should be recorded upon approval or of the rezoning by the City Council.
So these commitments would be would run to the property and yes. be in the official county records at the courthouse?
Exactly.
Other questions? A motion? Mr. Potasnik?
I move that we approve docket number 180300. I'm sorry. I move that we send this forward to the City Council. Docket number 180300002Z, 10680 and 10664 North College Rezone with the commitments requested by the department attached to that.
Thank you both. We have a motion and a second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? Thank you. This goes on to the council for their consideration.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. That concludes the public hearings and new business for tonight's agenda. We move on to old business and docket 1711-0014Z, Copperleaf PUD rezone with primary plat. The applicant seeks approval to rezone and to primary plat 22.4 acres to PUD planned unit development to develop 29 single family dwellings. The site is located on the south side of 131st Street and is west of West Road. The current zoning is S1 residential. Petition has been filed by Ice Miller LLP, Tim Oakes, on behalf of Pulte Homes of Indiana. Mr. Oakes.
Mr. President, I'll be recusing myself on this matter.
Thank you, Mr. Cassati.
Are you recusing yourself?
No, no.
Tim, please.
Okay. We have two recusals?
We have one.
Okay. Okay, thank you. President, members of the commission, again, good evening. I'm here this evening on behalf of Pulte Homes of Indiana, the petitioner on this project. With me here tonight is Dave Compton, Senior Vice President of Land Acquisition, and also Brandon Burke of HWC Engineering, the civil engineers for this project. Again, this was before the Plan Commission before and has gone to committee. Just to refresh everybody's memory, this is the project. This is the real estate that is the site, approximately 23 and a half acres. The western boundary of the site, it coincides with the county line. So on the other side is the Austin Oaks subdivision, which is in Boone County. Since we have gone to committee, what I'd like to do is focus on the changes that have been made as a part of the committee process. And to do that, I'll start on tab 3 of your booklets, if you have that, which is the red line version. The first thing I'll note is section 4.5, which is page 6 on the red line version of the PUD in tab 3. We have included a requirement to have street lighting, which includes an LED lighting, and then spacing that had the effect of adding two additional street lights in a subdivision that has only 28 or 29 homes to increase the light for the subdivision for purposes of safety. Able to walk out at night. Second is the bottom of that page, section 4.9. We added a separate section to deal with lot 29. And to refresh everyone's memory, this is lot 29. That is the existing farmhouse that is on the property. It is a very old farmhouse. It is listed as historic in nature. It has been renovated on the inside, I understand, very nicely, and the owner lives in that house and plans to continue to live in that house as we move forward. Because of the unique circumstances, it needs to be part of the PUD, it needs to be part of the plat. So we added section 4.9 dealing with lot 29. It now includes requirements related to minimum lot width at building line, minimum lot width at building line along Copperleaf Boulevard, minimum lot area, minimum front yard setback, minimum yard setback from the eastern boundary line, minimum setback from the southern lot line, maximum lot coverage, maximum building height, and then minimum ground floor area as well. Now all apply to lot 29. In addition, if you turn over to page 7, parts B and particularly C, C provides that if something happens to the house, heaven forbid, if it catches fire and burns down, or if it's voluntarily removed, at that point in time, the existing access onto 116th Street, which Carmel Engineering says is perfectly fine, that will no longer be used. It will be shut down, and then the access for lot 29 at that point when it's rebuilt would be into Copperleaf Boulevard on the interior of the project. So we think we've integrated lot 29 into this PUD, into the primary plat, but still allowed for flexibility and recognition of its historic and existing nature. Continuing on with the changes that have been made at the committee level, over on page 12, we really worked on landscaping, but in particular landscaping along homes that whose sides are adjacent to common areas or who back up the common areas. So, and then a couple of homes where you have a lot whose side is adjacent to two, basically a corner lot, two right-of-ways. That's lot 17, or 16 and 7 here. So we added additional landscaping standards. So the front yard landscaping standards would apply on both sides of the street, both frontages. Turning over to page 14, we added a requirement that every house will now have a minimum 3-foot sidewalk that will extend from the front porch, the front door, directly to the sidewalk that is perpendicular to the street. We also added a requirement in subsection C that the multi-use path that we must build along 131st Street will be extended to the west to connect to the existing path located in Boone County, of course subject to approval of the applicable governmental authority over in Boone County, which we believe will be Zionsville. Section 8.6, again, which is on page 14, we've added a specific requirement regarding signage that will be posted for the ponds that will be located on the property to state that they're stormwater BMP natural preservation areas. Do not mow or spray, to make sure they're taken care of. Finally, with respect to the plat itself, or the lot layout, we added a bend in Copperleaf Boulevard down towards the south here to, in an attempt to avoid, I think at the original Plan Commission hearing, it was called a bowling alley, perhaps, effect. That was intended to deal with that. Also, I think this is a pretty good illustration. We have a minimum 40% of open space. We could make these lots bigger. We could extend all the lots here and here, and make them much, much deeper. We didn't want to do that primarily because we wanted to maximize the open space. And what that allows is it puts under professional management through the Homeowners Association the management and upkeep of all of that common area and all of the landscaping that will occur in that common area. And by doing so, we avoid problems and we make sure that the subdivision in the long run is maintained at a very high standard. Turning to the architectural standards, I'll point out some additional changes that were made at the committee level. items 1 and 3, the lot width and setbacks, those were made to make be consistent with the language of the PUD. The front yard is 25 feet still. The side yard is a 3-foot minimum with an aggregate of 19 feet, and that's a reflection, really, of the fact that every single home is required to be a side-load garage. Then going over to the C2, the next page, all homes will have a full basement, obviously for the portions of the home that are not on the basement, such as the garage, that must be on a slab. There will be no crawl spaces. With respect to the windows, we made substantial changes, actually very simple. Two windows per floor per side is really what all the changes in Section 10 involve. Now, because we have a side load garage, the windows in the garage, even if there are multiple windows, will only count as one window, so there'll be another window on the first floor. But that was a change. Turning the page over to the masonry requirements, we had a provision that allowed for a reduction or elimination of some of the masonry requirements for historical structures such as a farmhouse, which has become very popular. The concern at the committee was that the exception could swallow the rule. So we put in a provision that limited how close and how many of those exceptions could exist so that there are only 5 homes that would qualify for that style or historical style of home that would avoid the masonry requirements. So masonry still exists. The front has to, except for those historical styles, must contain 50%. And there is a wainscot requirement around all sides of the house, both sides and the rear. Section 14 was a new section we added to deal with sides adjacent to open spaces, and we specifically listed all of the lots in the subdivision that had sides that were adjacent to a common area where the side would be more readily visible than with a lot that was directly adjacent to another lot. And on those, we require additional perimeter landscaping, which is 5 shrubs along that side of the house that's adjacent to the common area. In addition to that, the side of the house must use one architectural feature that's listed on Exhibit G, which is just a 4 or 5 pages ahead in the booklet. And so one of those architectural standards, a change in material pattern, a change in color with trim, architectural detailing, change in pattern and material, or a gable peak change in material must be included. So what that means is that sides of homes that are adjacent to common areas must have a wainscot and must have windows. All windows must have wood siding. There will be increased perimeter landscaping and changes in architectural pattern according to Exhibit G. So we think we've achieved true four-sided architecture for this particular project. Now, we thought we had worked through all the issues, and at the committee level, we had two full, I think, pretty robust meetings at the committee level. Unfortunately, the vote was 3-2 to recommend a negative recommendation to the council. And based on what was indicated to us at that committee meeting, and obviously some of the members are here, one member is no longer on the commission and one member has now recused himself. I don't want to necessarily speak for them, but it was our understanding that the sole issue related to those negative votes was one of density. And I want to address that issue square on. So first, what I'll do is refer everyone to tab 7 in your booklet. At the original Plan Commission hearing, there were some very upset neighbors, and I think that I suspect there was just some misinformation and going on, and hopefully that's been corrected. But what is in front of you on the screen here is we took the general area of this proposal, which is right here. And any area on this map that is white is an area that has not yet been platted. It's not been subdivided. So every single subdivided property on this map is in a color. And then what we did is we pulled the plat for every single one of those subdivisions, and we looked at what the density was for that plat. And the table up here lists the name of the subdivision and the total acreage and the overall density in terms of units per acre. We did include one subdivision in Boone County. That was the one that was directly adjacent to and to the west, Austin Oaks, which is a rather large subdivision. As a matter of fact, total number of units is more than any other subdivision on the list. And as you can see, the average density for this entire area is 1.45 units per acre. If you include lot 29, we're at 1.3. If you don't include lot 29, you take out the lot plus the acreage associated with it, we're at 1.40, which is less than the average density for the area. And then finally, I think it's worth noting that we are sensitive to the lots that are the parcels of real estate that are directly to our east. Those are not subdivided parcels. Those are large tracts of land that might have a single home on them. So we have been sensitive to that design. So this is an aerial photograph. This area is part of our project, and it's one of the reasons why we have so much open space, particularly on the east and west sides of this project, because we want to preserve these areas. So as you can see here, this is a pretty substantial area in terms of woods and buffering. None of that is going to be removed. All of it that's on the real estate that's part of this project will remain in common area, so that we don't have any homeowners that say, oh geez, I really would like to see the sun come through there, I'm going to cut them down. They can't. It's going to be in common area. That's one of the reasons why we maximize that common area. So this is looking kind of to the east and to the south. So this is almost the entirety of the home is right up here, right off the photo. And then this aerial is looking to the southwest. And again, this is Austin Oaks up here. This is, you can see the tennis court here. This is their amenities, so we're not backing up to any homes here. And again, all of this area here will be preserved. The setback over on this west side is about 50 feet. And then over here on the east side is 85 feet. We wanted to be very, very sensitive to the uses to the east, particularly, but we were even so to the west. And frankly, we are below the average density for subdivisions in this area. So we feel like this project is entirely consistent with the area and that density is adequate. So with that, despite the recommendation from the committee, we do respectfully request that the Plan Commission vote favorably on this recommendation, and we'd be happy to answer any questions that the Plan Commission might have.
Thank you, Tim. The department report.
Thank you. The petitioner has made several changes to the PUD and the primary plat since the first PC, the first Plan Commission meeting. They have addressed all of our concerns as well up to this point. Some of the changes that they made include installing the missing path connection. They agreed to do that to the west, the part that will be in Boone County. And they've made several changes to the architectural design, which was one of staff's major concerns. And a minimum of 2 windows per floor per side is now required. And that was a big push for us. We think that will enhance the architecture on all four sides of the building, as well as windows are important to provide cross ventilation and daylighting, access for daylighting into the homes. They've also improved the landscaping on the plans, added extra landscaping to some of the common areas, added seating area around near the pond so that that can be more of an amenity area as well. And then this area in the comprehensive plan is classified as a state residential, and this subdivision we could classify under the low-intensity suburban residential, which if you look at the comprehensive plan, it would be considered a best fit next to a state residential. And I think they've been done a good job at providing the transition and buffering to the adjacent properties. They've got very large buffer yards along the east and the west, 50 feet and 75 feet. And they've got over what would normally be required, the required amount for open space as well. So we are in support of this project, and we would recommend a favorable recommendation back or up to the City Council. Thank you.
Thank you. Sue, do you have a report for the committee, please?
I think that the petitioner and the department pretty much summed this up. There were a lot of changes made at the request of the committee and the department, and I would actually think they came through on everything except the density. And from day one, when this project was rolled out in here, density was a great concern, and nothing was changed on that. So three of the five members felt to not vote for this because no changes had been made to density.
Thank you. Discussion from members of the commission. Mr. Adams.
Thank you. I realize a lot of work has been done on this, but you know, we have to take zoning changes very, very seriously, especially when it affects residential areas, because we live and die by zoning. And if we ever get into a mode where we can change it arbitrarily, we're in deep trouble. But the problem I have with this is that it's a PUD that, in my mind, doesn't offer the kind of advantages to everybody concerned that we're accustomed to. You know, and a PUD has several requirements that we're supposed to pay special consideration to. One of them is it should allow for some kind of mixed use or address unusual site conditions. Well, this is not mixed use, not unusual. It could obviously be developed under the current zoning. It's not totally compatible with the comprehensive plan. And I mean, I could go on, but it's not really totally consistent with the character of current structures. And in my opinion, it's really not responsible development in this particular location because of the density and the reasons I mentioned before. So I can't I can't support this. And I apologize to the petitioner and all the others of you that put a lot of work in on this, but I still have problems changing this zoning when it's already, in my opinion, good enough for the area that it's in.
Other questions or discussion? Mr. Kessner.
The zoning's already been done, right? All we're doing now is ADLS.
Yeah, this is a motion to consider the proposed plan unit development rezone. Yes. Ms. Campbell.
I am impressed with the work that the committee did on this project because I'm on the commercial committee, and so I only saw this at the very beginning. So I think it's truly come a long way. I like the four-sided architecture, the tree preservation. I think there's enough of a buffer. I'm not that concerned with the density issues. So if there's somebody who could speak to that, because I think it's close, but if there's somebody who could give me more information, I wasn't able to sit on the committee meeting.
I would love to bend your ear on that, Councilwoman. I asked for that exhibit that Mr. Oakes presented where it shows us the density map, because to me, I think that that's always the most integral part of that conversation. You know, what's going on, what's like, what's not like. I think the map speaks for itself. To kind of go back on something that both staff and Mr. Oakes and Commissioner Westermeyer pointed out was, if that vote in our committee was held tonight, it would have been a 2-1 positive recommendation. But because it was held on that night, based on those circumstances, it was a 3-2 negative recommendation. I don't know if you're reading that or not, but okay.
Other discussion or a motion?
I move that we send this back or send this to the full council with a favorable recommendation.
Second.
Thank you both. All in favor of the motion to forward this to the council with a favorable recommendation, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? No. Mr. Adams, Mr. Kestner. That would put us at a 6 votes in favor, and that is a majority of the 9-member commission, so the motion carries. Thank you. Mike, would you find Mike for us, please? Mike Hollibaugh, would you find Mike Cassati for us, please? Next item on our agenda is the return of docket 18020002, DP ADLS, College and 116th Townhome Community. The applicant seeks site plan and design approval for 59 townhome lots or attached dwellings on 4 acres. The site is located at the southwest corner of 116th Street and College Avenue. Zoning is College and 116th PUD under ordinance Z-626-17. Petition has been filed by Jim Shinover of Nelson and Frankenberger on behalf of Onyx and East LLC. John.
Good evening, and for the record, my name is John Dabashewitz. I'm a land use professional at the law firm of Nelson and Frankenberger. Jim Shinover and I are here this evening on behalf of Onyx and East LLC. On behalf of the petitioner is David Lesenby here this evening, as well as the project architect and engineer. Due to the delay in the committee meeting, it was conducted last week rather than 2 weeks prior. We provided a digital copy of the information that we had reviewed with the committee to staff. My understanding is that was distributed to the Plan Commission members, and if you only have digital copies, I have paper here if you'd like to follow me through my presentation to have it in front of you.
The trees have been killed, so any takers?
If they're going straight from your hand to the trash, John, we'll take one too.
There were several items that the Plan Commission asked about, ones we reviewed with the committee at your meeting. To start out with, there were questions regarding mailbox locations, and we reviewed that with the committee. Adjustments made to the parallel parking spaces, which were reviewed at the committee level as well. There are 2 exhibits that I'll provide additional detail on in a moment. Question came up on our site plan regarding parallel parking spaces. That was addressed. An additional item that you see here on the color display. Question came up, if you follow on the screen, there were questions about the connections of sidewalks between these locations that are not in the right of way, but on the areas in the private drives. Question came up regarding crosswalks to be provided at those locations as well. We have committed that, and we've reached out to engineering. They haven't provided a response yet. In the event that the city engineering department would be in support of crosswalks being provided at those locations, we would provide those. We just want to make sure that that meets the city specifications, and in the event that it does, we would provide additional striping of those areas where there's crosswalks at the private drives, rather than just as identified here within the public right-of-way. There were questions regarding the bicycle parking. That's identified under tab 2. We've provided exhibits of typical locations within the garages where bicycle parking would be provided. Lighting fixtures and light levels were also a item that was discussed. We provided staff this afternoon a revised lighting study that's in full compliance with regard to the light levels. There were a couple locations within the right-of-way that the light levels were exceeded, right here adjacent to the lift station facility, as well as right here along College Avenue. And the issue there was regarding the street lighting fixtures being located in our common areas rather than in the right-of-way. So if you move this light fixture 2 feet away, it's in the street. It's a street light, but the way the ordinance reads, it's in a common area and it's a lighting fixture on site, so it can't exceed the foot candles at the right-of-way, so that we adjusted the location of those fixtures so that they are in full compliance with the lighting requirements in the ordinance. So we would ask to strike that condition of approval, as we've submitted that to staff as noted under item 5 in the explanation that we provided. We also submitted specifications with regard to the lighting style, the style of fixture on the buildings, and then we also provided enhanced details of the pond. Those included specifications with regard to lighting, as well as pedestrian amenities, including seating at these locations. You can see the darker shaded area in gray. We talked about pavement details in those locations. And then the white lines you see on the plan that I'm outlining here around the seating areas, as well as along the internal drive. That's designed with brick on the sides to match the building elevations, as well as being capped with a cast stone element that creates seating along those perimeters along the facilities. That was a primary component of questions that was received by the Plan Commission at your last meeting. The last item that we reviewed was regarding site drainage. We spent some time at the last Plan Commission meeting reviewing this. We were asked to provide an exhibit, which we did. That exhibit's on the screen now. The area that is shaded in gray is that area which today sheet drains to our west. And the revision shown here in the crosshatched area is the 15 feet between the driveway and the side property line. It's only that area that now continues to sheet drain to the west. The pre-development condition provides for approximately 0.9 acres that currently sheds to the west. The post-development condition is 0.13 acres, so it's about an 83% reduction in that area that drains to the west today. The gentleman who lives here to our west attended the committee meeting, and we spoke with him, and he was satisfied regarding the change that was being made. In addition to that, staff reached out to the engineering department and confirmed with them that they have no outstanding concerns regarding the drainage plan for the site, so that we felt, and I believe the committee felt comfortable in making its recommendation back to the full Plan Commission for your consideration this evening for approval of the development plan and ADLS by a vote of 4-0. With that, we'll conclude. We'd be glad to address questions that the full Plan Commission has in advance of making your request for adoption consideration this evening.
Thank you, John. The department report.
Thank you. We had several comments at the first Plan Commission meeting, a lot of them relating to the primary plat or making sure that this proposal met the PUD that was previously approved. Since then, the petitioner has addressed all of our comments. They've made several changes to the plat and the design to make sure that they meet the PUD as well. One of the other concerns we had was just looking more in more detail at the pond area and the seating areas around there and really making sure that this was an enhanced area that would be an amenity for the residents. So they did provide us with those details, and we think that that is they did a good job of kind of beefing up the design for those seating areas, so it's not just concrete slab with a bench on it. There's some more character in those areas. With that being said, you know, we have no other outstanding comments, so we do recommend approval of this item this evening. Thank you.
Thank you. Committee report?
Not much to add, just that the supplementary materials that they did provide us at the committee meeting seemed to answer all of our questions, so we passed it 4-0.
Thank you. Discussion questions from members of the Plan Commission? Laura.
Under number 4, the garage bike racks, this issue came up during our land use meeting, and the majority of council are concerned about dictating what goes on inside of buildings. So could somebody explain how this came about?
I will. One of the things that we talked about was that we really didn't want, we wanted to provide people a place to hang, to put their bikes in the garage as opposed to them ending up on their front stoops. So we thought that if part of the PUD process, because if we're going to talk about every nut and bolt in the PUD, if we suggest that they added bike hangers inside the garage, then that might encourage people to then use that space inside the garage as opposed to them ending up on the front porches. And I hope I don't talk for you, but I don't feel like we were pushing very hard. I felt like they thought that was kind of a good idea, if you will. So that's how we came up with that, and that's where we came up. It was me.
Is there something else we can do? Because I think this will become an issue. We opted to just, we approved the, we sent it back with a positive recommendation to the council, but this will be an issue. Is it possible, could we remove that bike rack in the garage portion and maybe put something else in, you know, requiring maybe that bicycles must be parked within the garages, something else, so we're not dictating exactly what needs to be done in, within a building.
I mean, I made the recommendation, if city council has an issue with it, I don't mind suggesting, you know, hey, do it if you want to do it, but we're not asking you to do it. Is that what you mean? So you would just ask that we not make that as a commitment to the PUD,
yes.
And if they want to do it on their own, that's what they want to do on their own. Then I guess, John, you heard all that?
Yes, sir. How was it? I mean, I see it here informationally, but was language added to the PUD text?
That's correct. At the time of the rezone, that was an item which was discussed. It was forwarded by the Plan Commission to Council, and Council adopted the rezone with this requirement. So today we're here in front of the Plan Commission asking for an approval because our plans fully comply. And to fully comply, we have to provide, and not necessarily an illustration, but we have to show compliance. This is something that will be reviewed at the time the building permit CFO is issued, and staff will go in, and as they do with all other assets, aspects of the plan, does it meet the elevation requirements? Does it do all this? And they'll look for that item to be included because it's required pursuant to the ordinance which was adopted. We can't opt out, in essence, not that we would propose to, but the only mechanism by which we could proceed and not provide that would be to seek a variance from the BZA, as it's a requirement. The PUD sets the requirement. If an ordinance was proposed and passed on by the Plan Commission and heard by the City Council to eliminate this requirement from the PUD, that's another avenue that would be available. I'm not suggesting we would propose to bring that in front of the Plan Commission, but today we're looking for your approval of a plan that fully complies. Without it, we don't fully comply.
I think what you've described is a situation where the fix is more painful than moving forward as is. I apologize because I was unaware that requirement for what goes on within essentially the four walls of each townhome was a part of the PUD text. I completely agree with Councillor Campbell that this is in my mind an overreach. I understand the objective, and I've seen that problem elsewhere in the community, but I certainly think that there are better solutions that don't micromanage the developer or the behavior of the owners.
And if I may offer some context as to why it may be coming up now, there was a discussion regarding the Gramercy PUD that was heard in front of the council and adopted last evening about this specific text. Was also incorporated into that PUD because it was perceived at the time that was reviewed in a favorable light. But this item was passed by the council in January, adopted, the ordinance was adopted, so now we're in a position to show compliance for your approval. Again, as described, there would be another mechanism if, and we've talked about, Jim stepped up and we talked and our client has indicated that they, again, we don't have it, it's not that we have the choice to opt in or opt out, we're required by the ordinance that was adopted.
Mr. Molitor?
You said something about the solution being more painful than the original problem, but may I suggest that the staff keep this on its list, and when we start looking at if we need to tweak the UDO in regard to our signage regulations because of issues that the courts have now created for us, perhaps this is something else we could look at, and that there's be some restraint placed on the Plan Commission that it not include in PUDs provisions that affect the interior of a building. And I don't think anyone on the Plan Commission feels that strongly about it in any event. So that might be something for us to consider in the near future.
I certainly did not mean to cause as much of a turmoil about bike parking, but I think we talked about it. We just kind of thought it was a good plan at the time.
Well, it helps that in this case, I assume we had a very eager and compliant petitioner as well. I will say that when the first draft of this plan that I saw, I kind of shrugged my shoulders at, but as it stands today, this is a project that appears to be something that Carmel will be very proud of. And so to the petitioner, thank you for all the work you've done. I think this is going to be a lovely project based on the plans as they stand today. Are there other questions, including Mr. Kessner's?
I might just make one comment about the bike racks. You know, you're talking about putting in wordage that all bikes are required to be inside. Well, putting in bike racks is really a more positive way because this encourages them to do it without. So, you can look at it either way.
I've got towel racks at home with piles of towels on the floor underneath them that don't fulfill that objective very, very well. But your optimism is laudable, Nick. Other questions or motion?
I'll move that we approve docket number 1802002 DP/ADLS College at 116th Townhome Community.
Second.
Thank you both. It's been moved and seconded to approve this docket. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed, same sign. Petition is approved.
Thank you for your time this evening.
And finally, under new business, docket 1802-0009 ADLS, amend, Tom Wood Jaguar Land Rover Volvo remodel. Applicant seeks site plan and design approval for 2,600 square foot building addition and remodel. The site is located at 4620 East 96th Street and is zoned B3 business. Petition has been filed by Roger Ward with Roger Ward Engineering on behalf of Tom Wood.
Good evening. My name is Mike Belay with Belay Architects. I'm the architect on the project. Roger Ward wasn't able to be here. I think we're going to be talking primarily about architectural issues anyway, so I'm the one they elected to come present this. But I wanted to give a brief overview of the scope of the project. I don't know whether this will even... Yeah, that's not too bad. what we're proposing to do is basically demolish the existing showrooms and front facade of the car dealership and replace it with new showrooms and a new facade. This is the new facade. I have a photograph here of the existing facade as well. It's in your packet. So we're going from this to this. It's similar materials. It's ACM or aluminum composite material panels and glass storefront curtain wall. The amount of the glass in the Jaguar and Land Rover showrooms is significantly reduced from the existing building. This is due to the image program requirements as well as energy conservation issues. This design was presented or given to us by the manufacturers, architects who create corporate image programs that the dealers are required to comply with as part of their franchise agreements. We presented this to the commercial committee about 6 weeks ago and had mostly favorable reactions. There was a couple of minor things that we needed to address. One was bike racks, which have been added. The other was some lighting issues at the property lines, which Rachel and Janine Burkhardt, who's with me. Janine is a lighting consultant from Light Source. She's here. When I get into the Volvo issue, we're going to talk about a light fixture issue. So the big question that came up at the committee meeting was the facade of the Volvo showroom, which, you got that? Thank you. Is our our rendering doesn't show it very well. It shows it as an opaque sort of white metal panel, but it's not really that. I have some photographs here of actual facilities that have been constructed. And as you can see, the facade is made up of a curtain wall that goes from the ground all the way to the top of the parapet. About 85% of that curtain wall is translucent, and it's going to be translucent by etching and coating the insulated glass panels that are inserted into the curtain wall. And those are the samples that Rachel's holding there. And then that translucent glass is lighted from the ambient lighting inside the showroom. But additionally, the franchise agreement, the corporate image program, has a requirement for a light. I don't know if you can see this, but over here is this line here is the ceiling in the showroom, and then the glass extends all the way to the top of the parapet. So we have to have a way to light that plenum space up there so it reflects out evenly on the facade, if that makes sense. Now, that requirement, this is from the design intent document, which is given to us by the factory architects that we are supposed to comply with. And so this is a picture of my drawing that kind of shows the same thing. Right here, this is the ceiling of the showroom, which is at 21 feet. And then this is the plenum space, which has got to be lighted. Now, I think the issue that the committee and staff had with this light was that its only purpose is really to backlight this translucent glass. And there were some concerns about that. and also some concerns about what Rachel called hot areas. And you can see that in this particular building here. Up at the top, you can see this strip light, how it creates sort of a segmented, like a 4-foot fluorescent tube would. And there was some objection to that, that we wanted a more even distribution of the light similar to this project here. So we've been working on that with a light fixture. And I'd like to plug that light fixture in for you so you can see what we're doing and maybe put it behind the glass so you can see what we're proposing. But the a small LED strip. This comes in up to 8-foot lengths. But what we're proposing to do is have it custom made so that each length is the same width as the frames in the curtain wall. So the joint between pieces would occur at each frame. And then the intent here is that this is going to be up on a soffit. I don't know if you can see how that. Okay. So what we're trying to achieve here is a very diffused light. We don't, as the designer and also as the franchise, we don't want the hot strip of light, hot spot at the top of the glass either. We prefer a more even distribution. We're also proposing that we add a translucent filter over this light strip that will even diffuse it even more. So it has a lens on it already that's translucent. We're going to add another one, and then we got translucent glass. So we're hoping that we get nice even distribution with this light.
And then.
I could see
the blue part lights up too behind the Volvo. So it's all glass all the way across.
Yeah, and we've included the blue area as part of our spandrel and the signage proposal, and that's okay. We're good there. Now, we do need 3 variances for extra signs on the building, which we're doing that process with BZA. But specifically, This issue of the translucent glass is really specifically what we're here to talk about. So with that, we'll take any questions you have.
Thank you. Report from the department.
Thank you. Just to reiterate some of that from committee, when we got to committee, we had just learned that it was going to be illuminated, like right before the meeting, and we were looking up other Volvo dealerships to try and understand what this translucent glass panel would look like. And that was one of our review comments was, what does this look like and how will it be? Is it similar to metal panel and it'll just be white? But then when we looked up, other locations around, from the internet, then we saw that it was lit. And that was very concerning to us because there are many different ways that it could be done, and it could have hot spots like in the top left, or it could be a gentle washing of light. But we were just concerned that wasn't quite the look that we wanted. And we were also concerned about it, functioning like a sign, a very large sign on the outside of the building with it being illuminated from within, turning the whole thing into a spandrel panel. But we met with the petitioner and we really kind of drilled it down and talked about it and got to the point of we can do what we showed you tonight, which is have, well, it'll be a large, long fixture that's mounted up into the ceiling, and it'll have this extra layer of diffusion so that we won't have this kind of hot spot appearance behind the glass. And, you know, we were hoping that they could just eliminate this light altogether, but it is a requirement from the dealership. And technically, if we didn't have the light up there, it would be like dark up there, and that the light, the ambient lighting from within the showroom, you know, wouldn't really light it the way that they want it to. So by having the light at the ceiling and coming down, it'll provide that nice washing of light and a glow across the facade. Now, because there's really no signs, you know, the light itself is not a sign, I can't say that they're violating the sign ordinance by having these interior lights. We do call out the spandrel panel, as we talked about with the blue area. The blue coloring creates a specific spandrel, as we call it, for the defining of where the sign can go and how big the sign can be. So the proposed Volvo sign that will be placed over the blue glass area does meet the sign ordinance requirements for size. And this building, Mike, correct me, is it more like the top right with the two panels of glass? Or do we have
correct.
One?
That's correct. So there's a horizontal piece, yes.
There's a horizontal piece dividing it. So it's unlike the one on the left.
That horizontal piece is approximately about 3 feet below the ceiling level inside the showroom.
Yes. So that horizontal piece helps also create the spandrel panel for where we define where the sign can go and how big the sign can be. So overall, you know, staff has worked with the petitioner on this lighting issue that really isn't something that we have a lot of control over because it's within the inside of the building, as we were just talking about with another petition. But we do have control in the way that it affects the way that the outside of the building looks, and that is part of the overall ADLS process. So that's why we went through great lengths to understand what the materials were that they're proposing, what the fixtures were going to be, how they're going to be installed, and if there's any way that we can add things within the realm of what the dealership requirements are so that our concerns can be addressed. And they don't want it to look bad either. And we're not saying that it will look bad. We're just trying to eliminate all concerns from the get-go. So that's the deal on the Volvo side and the lighting from the inside. I'll give you just a quick update for those who weren't at the committee on the rest of the building proposal changes. You saw what the Jaguar and Land Rover would look like. It'll be a metal gray panel. They're reducing the amount of glass on their side, which is fine. We think it'll be a more modern look for that half of the building. There are very few changes to the site plan. They are removing some parking spaces in front of the building in order to bump out this new showroom area and new facade. But where they are adjusting the parking, they're also adding in permeable pavers. So that's a positive offset for losing some of those parking spaces. The site lighting is in compliance for parking lot lighting. They will have LED fixtures, and they do meet requirements at the property lines for the maximum amount of foot candles. There's very little changes to the landscaping, and the Urban Forester has approved the landscape plan. And as Mike mentioned, I think you mentioned it, the signage that they are requesting, there's currently a variance for 5 signs right now. They're asking for 3 more small signs, which are related to the service areas, and then a of Indianapolis sign, which we cannot control the content of that sign and what it says. But it's a...
But it's a shame it's not a shorter six-letter word.
It is. Hey. It is. It is. We wish it said that. But anyway, they have requested a variance for those signs, and that will be heard at the BZA coming up. So this was brought to the full plan commission as a way to keep the project moving and give the petitioner the opportunity to not be delayed to the next committee meeting, but we ended up pushing it back anyway. So here we are for a final vote from you. This is just an ADLS amendment for the outside of the building. You can vote on it tonight, and we do recommend approval based on all of our talks and working on these lights and the extra diffuser that was added. So I'd be happy to answer more questions if you have them.
Thank you. Committee report?
I think Rachel's done a very good job with that. She specified specifically what why it's coming here to the full plan commission, which is to keep the process moving forward and not to put them out by having another committee meeting. But since this is something new, it was an idea that we wanted to make sure that the full plan commission had a clear understanding about. And yes, it was brought up at the time that why are you using the word Indianapolis in Carmel? So we'll see what happens when it goes to the BZA.
Mr. Kirsch.
I'm sorry to ask this question at this point in the game, but I'm sitting here the whole time wondering about the whole conversation we had about, is it sixth, whatever it is. 60. I feel like we had this same conversation with them, and I hate to hate on their orange, and I hate to love the Volvo colors, but is there a comparison here? Is this apples to oranges? Can I vote on this tonight and feel like a clear conscience?
Yes, I believe you can, because that one was an add-on to the outside of the building that was essentially a sign cabinet that was an interior illuminated orange piece that was put on the outside. This is a light fixture from within the building shining down onto the glass.
Thank you very much. Yeah.
I saw this originally, I first thought of sixth, and I'm like, we have a duplicate here. But
okay.
We don't.
It's different. Apples and oranges. Thank you.
Other discussion? Or a motion? Mr. Adams.
I'll move that we approve docket number 18020009, ADLS amend, Tom Wood, Jaguar, Land Rover, Volvo remodel.
Second.
Thank you both. If there's no further discussion, all in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Move to adjourn.
We will be adjourned with one comment of thanks to Lisa Motes and the staff for all of their work digesting an unbelievable volume of email messages over the past several weeks. Those will continue, so buck up. But thank you for your efforts. We appreciate it very much. We will be adjourned.